Aftersession.
Okay. I don't remember your name, sir, and I don't want to say your name on the podcast anyway. I am so sorry. I forgot about your meme. I literally answered you during my lunch break. So I was probably not even thinking about it. So you're probably going to get another email from me this evening, like 5 days later, and go, what's this?
So your guaranteed Nick Cage meme.
The guaranteed Nick Cage meme that I forgot to send you, and I feel bad. But thank you again for your email. I'm hoping that my suggestions helped you.
Yep, we try.
I feel bad. Late Nick Cage is better than
Nah, don't.
Oh,
Nick Cage is never late. He arrives precisely when he means to. Because he's secretly a wizard as I cross my movie stream.
Nick Cage is everything to everybody. That's why we adore him.
That is true.
Oh, goodness. Okay, so our theme, our topic for the after session, which Amber called savory. And since this is the after session, I can swear.
There's going to be a little bit of pepper in it, methinks.
Yes. Cons don't give a shit about cosplayers. There you go. There's the theme. This came about because of, and I'm going to call them out too, and that's fine, of the WeebCon, which I'm sure some
that's
of
the
you...
name. That's the name of the show. Yes. We're not nicknaming it in any way. We're not meaning it to be derogatory. That is literally the name of the show.
It is called WeebCon. And I know Sensei Starman, you know exactly what I'm talking about. I believe this is their fourth year. Feel free to correct me on that one, Sensei, but I'm pretty sure it's the fourth year for it. And I heard good things about the event until this year. And it seemed like there was a lot of behind the scenes stuff that happened last year that just amplified this year. And WeebCon, it just became on the shit list for everybody for how they treated cosplayers and the cosplay contests. Like people put really scathing reviews on Instagram, and WeebCon has been completely dead quiet about it. I think they know they messed up.
Also, Sakura, you are correct. No salt for this. Just the pepper half of salt and
pepper. Yes, we just want the pepper.
Yeah, we are not salty because we did not attend.
No, I knew it was going on only because I had a friend that was vending there. It was the same weekend as FakeCon. And I was initially going to go, okay, one day for FakeCon and then one day for WeebCon because I was curious. But then life had other things happen, so I couldn't do either, unfortunately. So I got to live vicariously through my friends that went to both of those. And the things I heard about WeebCon were just astronomically bad. So I'm going to give the basic overview and then we'll go into the cosplay-centric stuff because there's a ton of things that went wrong, but I don't want to go over those since we're cosplay-related podcasts. Let's focus on the cosplay stuff.
Yep.
The basic deets are it took place at the Gaylord Resort in Grapevine, Texas, which is people were calling it like Texas KatsuCon because KatsuCon takes place at the Gaylord there. We don't
Isn't
have a gazebo.
Where they have ice?
Yes.
The sculptures?
They have the ice sculptures
so
there.
So you've probably seen that on the media. If you've ever seen Grapevine or the Gaylord in media, it's because of ice, which mm-hmm. is the sculpture show.
Yeah, and they do stuff throughout the year because I drive by there fairly often. It's mm-hmm. it's in a weird place of the city because it's kind of all out on its own. Across the highway from it is Great Wolf Lodge, and then like 5 minutes mm-hmm. down the road is the Grapevine Mills Outlet Mall mm-hmm. and Bass Pro Shop. Mm-hmm. But it's like a mile stretch just to get to the front door of the hotel. It's very weird. But I've been there multiple times for QuakeCon. And mm-hmm. it's a nice setup. It's a nice hotel. A very mm-hmm. fancy hotel. Parking mm-hmm. is terrible. I thought it would improve in the last 5 years. But apparently they decided to not build the second parking structure that was promised. That's fine. Not. some of the big misses there were no water stations, which as a Texas con, that's unheard of, regardless of what time of year it is. Like, you always have water stations available to people.
I think usually even the hotel itself has water stations. Like, if you were to go there outside of major events, for pretty much any major hotel in Dallas, they will have water stations. So it kind of surprises me that they didn't.
They turned off also the couple of drinking fountains that were available there. It's like they were intentional.
So how did they offer water? Did they sell it only?
Yes. You could buy it from Starbucks for about $8 a bottle. Yeah. They were asking people to get sick at that point. Like, for a Texas con, like, I understand.
Dehydrated, certainly.
I understand that for a lot of northern and especially eastern, East Coast cons, that might be unheard of. But here, because of the heat is so prevalent, 365 days out of the year, we always have water stations made available to us. So it's weird when it's not available. So aside from that, so let's get to the cosplay stuff. The hotel had some pretty strict rules regarding cosplay. If you enter into the hotel itself, they have this huge atrium where they put up a lot of displays. Like, I've been there before where they had this really cool train exhibit, and there's like waterfalls, some cool rock sculptures, and it walks you out to this really great open restaurant area. No pictures allowed.
At a cosplay convention?
No pictures allowed. If you wanted to take pictures, you had to drop well over $1,000 for a photographer fee. And I think it was just for a daily fee.
Ah, okay. So they had an exclusivity clause in the contract with whatever photography firm they signed with that only they were allowed to take pictures.
No. It was anybody could pay that fee and be a part of the photography. So, I mean, like, it wasn't like an exclusive photographer. It was...
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah. If you want to take any pictures in their atrium, you had
to pay
a fee.
That sounds like some kind of exclusivity agreement. That seems bizarre.
It is very bizarre when you're in such a nice hotel. Cosplayers and the general attendees are going to want to take photos in those nice areas.
Especially if you have a picturesque place in the atrium, because a lot of hotels do. And it's like, oh, well, I want to get this waterfall feature as a backdrop for your costume. Like, some hotels have that as a selling point whenever they have conventions.
Yeah, and that would have been a big one, especially because I've been through there. I've walked through there. There are tons of places in that open atrium. And it's a huge atrium. It's kind of Las Vegas-esque in the way that it's kind of thrown around. So you could probably fit
another small building inside of their atrium. It's that big.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
So the fact that there were like no photography in that area whatsoever. And in general, the hotel was pretty picky about people taking photos, whether you were a cosplayer or not. But they seemed specifically to be gunning after cosplayers, regardless of where you were. They were like, no pictures, no pictures, no pictures. So it was like, you guys really don't want us to promote you whatsoever if you just, okay, whatever. The other thing that they instituted only like about a week and a half before the con itself, no bunny costumes of any kind. Now, you're probably wondering why. It's because the con took place over Easter weekend. The Gaylord Hotel does have Easter stuff that they do.
Okay.
And I'm sure that they were concerned that the people wearing the bunny girl outfits would be conflated with the convention. But given how very strict and like family oriented the Easter stuff was for the Gaylord, there is no way they would have assumed the cosplay attendees were part of their event. I think that was a little extreme. But more than anything, the fact that they only told con attendees like a week and a week and a half out, like some of these people had already made their costumes and were going to bring it. And now you're telling them, no, they can't do it.
Some of them may have already started traveling, depending on where they're from.
Yeah. So I think that was a bit of a miss. And especially since the way that the hotel is set up, there's a very easy divide between the hotel and the convention area. The people going to the convention, if they're not staying in the hotel, they could easily just focus on the convention area. Nobody would know that they were in a bunny outfit. No one would have had a clue. So I understand a little bit, but I do think that the fact that they waited so late to tell people and just the way that they conflated it was a little like, I'm not so sure about that. Editor Val here to clarify what I meant about no bunny costumes being an issue. When you hold an event during a holiday weekend, people generally take it upon themselves to dress up for the occasion, and cosplayers especially enjoy doing this to add different flair to their costumes. So think Holiday Matsuri, because that's a con that is tailored for the November and December holidays. So it comes off as very un-cosplay friendly when a con tells us to not wear something holiday related when the con is taking place during a holiday. Hope that helps.
It seems so restrictive that it almost comes across like it's discouraging cosplay in general.
Yeah, that was the attitude the people who attended that weekend are pretty much getting, especially when we get to the contest stuff. Yeah.
Like half the point of wearing a costume, which, I mean, yes, wearing a costume is to express fandom, and it's because you want to, like, show off what you enjoy in terms of, like, anime, video games, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, half the point is to get your picture taken.
Yeah.
Let's be real.
And to have fun and to meet new people and to have those great experiences of meeting other fans of mm-hmm. the same thing that you like. But it was just, like, mm-hmm. you're discouraging everybody from doing this thing. What's the point? Mm-hmm.
Were they also discouraging of these photos outside the hotel?
Yes.
Or just inside?
Both inside and
so
outside.
So anywhere on the grounds?
Anywhere on the grounds, yeah. It seemed like wow. there were certain areas within the convention hall itself that mm-hmm. you were okay. Because at mm-hmm. that point, there really wasn't a whole lot of convention security. And mostly hotel staff kind of ignored that. But if you were anywhere in the general hotel grounds, which is a pretty big chunk of the area, they mm-hmm. were like on you. Yeah, it's pretty unfortunate. The hotel really didn't want them there, but they were happy to take the money to have them there. Another big concern that I heard was that the cosplay guests that they did bring in were not really properly compensated. They had a hard time with their badges, with their rooms. They didn't get proper like meal vouchers. Some people, I think, are still waiting to get paid a month later or almost a month later. And also they tend to overflood, like they had just so many people just there, and it was difficult for anybody to really stand out and make themselves known. The big oopsie doodle was the contest itself. The short version of this is the contest was awful. What happened was the original cosplay coordinator was fired because of a disagreement between the con and what she wanted to do, and was like, this is what we need to do to improve. And the con said, we're done with you. We're picking somebody else. And this was like, a couple months before the event. So there's still plenty of time to put something together. The second person came in, left about a month-ish before the con because of the same situation. The con was just not giving them the resources they need to do their job. So they literally hired somebody like 3 weeks before the con to put the whole cosplay contest together. And they had medical emergency on top of that. So what resulted, it was a contest that started super, super late. By late, I mean it was scheduled for 5, but they pushed it back to 7 and didn't update anybody on that. So I'm sure that was great for the cosplayers. People that signed up online arrived there at the contest and were told, oh, we can't find your form, so you're not allowed in. That's lovely. Some people were prejudged, some were not. That's still kind of up in the air on what happened there. There were a couple of skits that were allowed to perform, but I don't think anybody actually checked the skits beforehand.
Previewed them?
Yeah. Because there were some inappropriate things that occurred. I don't know all of the inappropriate things, but I'm not going to say them. It's a possibility that allegedly somebody had a real sword while doing one of their skits.
That's dangerous. That's straight up dangerous. That's a massive no-no.
That's a big no-no, and I would, yeah. That's why I said allegedly. No one can confirm it for sure, but most people around said that it's very likely that it was real. There's questionability about the safety of the stage itself. Some people said that it felt very rickety and wobbly.
I feel like you could have stopped like 5 minutes ago and it already would have been enough.
Some people had complaints about the judges because most of the judges were more of like the model-y type. They weren't craftsmanship judges. They don't blame them for the situation. They know that the cosplay coordinator did their best with what they had and just kind of pulled whoever was available. Oh God, Amber's face is priceless. For the awards themselves, there really were no prizes. There were maybe like two or three plaques handed out, but that's it. Not even like a piece of computer paper that said, "You won this category." They got nothing. They had the honor of winning, which, that was fine 15 years ago when we were first starting because we really didn't get anything. We were lucky if we got dealer's room leftovers. Least I got a medal out of one of them. It was a blank medal, but I got a medal. But in this day and age, because of how important cosplay is to just the community and getting people invested and interested in a con, you want to give something back to them. You need to give them something. So to be like, congratulations, you get nothing. Cool. And because of the size of the event, they can't really take those costumes elsewhere to compete. They may be sandbagging, and that's just unfortunate. So now they're kind of stuck with this quote unquote winner title, but they have nothing to really show for it other than a really bad contest. So I am laughing
So
because I'm in pain.
what it sounds like is that this convention, and keep in mind, this is only my opinion. I have no like evidence to back this up. This is only my thoughts on the matter. It sounds like they were paying lip service to the concept of a cosplay contest without wanting to actually resource it like it was one. That it was important enough to merit priority. And they just basically wrote it off. Like, we're doing this because everyone expects it of us, but we're not actually gonna like put effort into it. That's how it comes across.
That's how it comes across. I listened to the Cosplay Crunch podcast, which is a new cosplay podcast, by the way. And they were specifically talking about WeebCon, and they brought on people who were past attendees, past judges, as well as current attendees. So they had like a good gamut of cosplayers who could kind of give some more insight into what happened. And someone from last year who was a judge said that, yeah, it was just like pulling teeth to get the bare minimum for anything for the cosplay contest. And seeing behind the scenes made them more aware of just where their priorities lie. And it was just had nothing to do with cosplayers. It really was just paying lip service so they could have the nice marketing pictures saying, "Hey, look, cosplayers, you'll love it here. Look at this cool location and this cool hotel. Won't you spend money here with us?" But without
Can we
actually giving them
pictures?
anything of value.
And the other thing, which setting aside the fact that real weapons is a major no-no and could actually like potentially be seriously like dangerous to somebody's life. Whenever you hold an event and you communicate with your fans or the attendees who will be going, you have to be consistent.
Yes.
It is when you start being inconsistent and either stop communicating or having to constantly come back and say, oh, sorry, we're changing it. Oh, sorry, we're changing it again. Oh, sorry, we got to change again. When you start having inconsistency, you lose people. And at that point, you're better off canceling the event. Because at some point, if you've told people that you will pay them a per diem, if you've told people they will get a room key, if you've told people that you will get a badge, like all of these things, and then all of a sudden, oh, we're sorry, we can't find your form, you can't do this. Oh, sorry, we don't have you on their list, we can't get you a room key. Oh, sorry, this person who agreed to the per diem is no longer with us. We're sorry, we can't give it to you. Like when you start getting into situations like that, not saying that's what happened at WeebCon, but when you start like going down that road, you're not going to have a convention much longer because your attendees won't trust you enough to go. And that's not just cosplay, that's for any kind of
Anything.
event you hold. That's panels, that's concerts, that's fan-held events, anything with voice actors or special anime guests, like any of that. You have to be consistent. When you give your word for something, that's it. You gave your word. You got to follow through with it. Or else this happens.
And from what the attendees were saying for the cosplay contest, like, if they knew 3 weeks out they still didn't have anything planned, they should have just canceled it. People would have been more accepting and understanding, and they just put those resources elsewhere. It seemed like in general, a lot more attendees this year had negative things to say because something was wrong everywhere. Like, inconsistent panel times, panels were canceled unexpectedly, panels were moved unexpectedly with no announcements anywhere. Because they had no, of course, cons, for the love of God, please have paper schedules. When you have even 1,000 people descend on your event, the Wi-Fi signal goes to hell. And we cannot download your PDFs. So please.
And that's assuming that everybody has a phone.
Yeah.
Because some people don't.
Some people still don't. And that's fine.
Some people have them and have very limited cell plans where they don't want to use up data on your app. Some conventions only have an app, and some people don't want to download your app to be able to just look at the schedule because all they need is just the schedule.
Or they don't have the space.
Right. And yeah, it's going to cost you money to print 1,000 guides. Yes. Yes, it will. But I think we're both in agreement that that's a cost that you should plan for.
Absolutely. 1,000%, especially at this point. And if something does happen to change, if you had a couple of huge white boards throughout key areas of the convention where you know people are going to have a lot of foot traffic, you can change it and you can make it easy for people to see instead of having them sit in a room for 45 minutes wondering what's happening with the panel. Like, that's ridiculous. How big was this con? I think around A-Fest level. It seems like it started out really, really tiny but grew super fast. I don't know where the original location was, but it, from my understanding, and people told me and give it a shot, was like, oh, it's like a really tiny con and it's got that small con feel to it. It's very relaxing, very chill. And then it just scaled up immensely because now we're talking about thousands and thousands and thousands of people. But like, apparently there was issues with getting signatures from voice actors. There was issues in the dealer's room. It just seemed like there were issues everywhere because they were trying to stretch themselves into doing everything. Whereas if they just tunnel their focus, and if they just want to do a market space, do a market space. If you just want to be a space where you have people visit their favorite voice actors, just do that. If you try to be everything to everyone, you're gonna fail.
And that seems to be happening to multiple conventions recently, because I know I've seen multiple posts on Reddit complaining about this convention or that because of that exact problem. Mm-hmm. They're trying to be all things to all people because they're trying to make profit from all things for all people. And the problem is that whenever you spread yourself that thin, you don't do any of it well.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to just, like Val said, picking maybe two or three things and putting all your resources into that and doing that really, really well, then your con becomes known for that.
Yeah.
And that's what people go to your con for. And are you all things to all people anymore? No. Are you going to lose some people? Sure. That's okay. Because when you have a well-run con, people come to you just for that fact. It's like the reason people go to Bucky's, because they have good bathrooms. Because that's what they're known for, is having the cleanest bathrooms of any gas station in America. Are they all things to all people? No. Do they have a great car wash? Who knows?
Who knows?
Do they have great parking? Who knows?
Yes, cheap gas? Actually.
Who knows? Who knows? But do they have great bathrooms? Yes. And that is why people go to them, and that's what they need to do for cons.
We praise and pray for the beaver in this house. All hail the golden beaver.
I mean, hilarious metaphor aside, for those who don't know what Bucky's is, it's basically a very luxurious gas station.
It's gas station attached. Heaven.
But we're finding that a lot of cons just kind of seem to feel this obligation to try and do everything for every fandom. It's like, you really don't.
No, you don't.
I mean, if you provide open tracks where fans can provide panels, fans will generally take care of things. I mean, yes, you need to do quality control and make sure that there aren't things that happen, like, say, at the cosplay contest, mm-hmm. where you didn't preview it first. And yes, you have to do quality control on it. But, I mean, other than that, I mean, you can just focus on running maybe a contest or two, maybe a concert, and then choose whether or not you want Artist Alley / Dealer's Den and an autograph area. Done. That's it. You don't have to have anything more complicated than that. And you don't even have to have all of those things. If you only want to have one contest, or if you don't want to have a concert at all. I mean, that's totally up to you as a con, but it's highly recommended that whatever you do, that you plan adequate resources for it. Because if it goes terribly, people talk.
Yep, and we talk fast, especially in the Texas community. We have a huge amount of cosplayers here. We make up a big chunk of our community. I would love it if we had a cosplay-only convention here, because people would flock to it. Absolutely, 100%.
If it was well-run.
If it was well-run. If it's a well-run cosplay convention.
Correct.
Let me fix that. I mean, it's just... This is part of the reason why I wanted to talk about this, because this came up in the Cosplay Crunch podcast, too, was it just got me thinking how in 2024... conventions still don't treat cosplayers very well. If we're guests, we have to fight tooth and nail to prove that we belong there. It's more than just getting a badge. It's getting our travel taken care of, having a hotel handled, having some type of food stipend. We're lucky if we get any of those things. Usually we don't. Usually we just get the badge and then we're expected to provide loads of content, usually like a minimum of 3 panels, which is an hour each, so 3 hours of work, plus working the cosplay contest, which as these days, it's one full day of pre-judging and one full day of the contest itself. So that leaves you with doing extra work on whatever your quote unquote free day is for hosting panels, and you get a badge out of it. Whereas other guests are paid to be there, and they don't have to work anywhere near as much. They maybe do one or two panels. They may only just be there for signings and nothing else. But they're getting paid on top of getting money percentages from their autographs and photo ops. And it's just frustrating
to me. To be fair to voice actors.
Sure, yeah.
Just setting aside that there are some voice actors that genuinely just do like panel after panel after panel. And will work the entire day.
Oh, yeah.
I have known voice actors who
we know.
Do that.
And oh, yeah. We've known them. We've seen them. We've met them.
So we're not saying this to be derogatory towards voice actors whatsoever. It's more that we would like to raise cosplayers to that same level of importance to the con. Because it should not necessarily be whether or not the guest can bring in additional attendees and make you money. Because the cosplayers are there as a service to the community, basically. Yeah. So are they going to necessarily have attendees who come just for that cosplayer?
Sure.
Not necessarily.
There's some yes, some no. I mean,
some will, but not everybody will. And that's okay. And that shouldn't necessarily be your metric for whether or not you should compensate a cosplayer. Like, all of your guests should be treated fairly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, notice I did not necessarily say equally, because I'm not necessarily saying everybody should get equal pay across the board. That's up to the convention.
Mm-hmm.
But fairly, yes.
Yeah, the whole point is to try to raise cosplayers up to that level, because we have been fighting for that for decades now, literally decades, just to try to get some recognition from the conventions. Like, we know we pull people in. We know that we are great for their marketing, because... You can't tell me that there isn't a convention out there that doesn't use cosplayers in their marketing somewhere at some time. We're on your banners, we're on your mailers, we're on your emails, we're all over your freaking website. Like, you guys need us to promote your con, and you continue to treat us like crap. Whether it's being a guest, being a judge, being somebody in the cosplay contest, because cosplay contests just seem to keep getting worse and worse over the years. And I'm going to say... I'm going to throw a number out there. I'm going to say 95% of the time it has nothing to do with the cosplay staff. It's all the convention, because conventions have a ridiculous amount of limitations on cosplay staff. And it is so hard to work with that. I know that there are times when we've wanted to do more, but we're also like, this is what we have to work with, and we got to stick to these limits. And it sucks so bad, because we just want to give our all, and we can't sometimes.
Right. And we realize, especially where it comes to things like prizes, that we try and do as much as we can with what we're given to make sure that not only cosplay guests, like judges, are compensated, but the winners of the contest too, because they also put their, sometimes literally, blood, sweat, and tears into their costumes and are spending hundreds of dollars and hundreds of hours to make these so that you have a contest. I have been to contests where there were five entries. Five. They had more prizes than they had entrants.
Yes.
And that was it. That was the contest. It was a grand 15 minutes. Yeah. So, I mean, in the same way that you won't have a con unless you have attendees, you don't have a contest unless you have contestants. And if you have a crappy contest, we know from experience, people will stop going to your contest.
Yep.
Not just the the contestants, but audience members will leave too.
Absolutely.
And then you won't have an audience. And if you don't have an audience, you also don't have a contest, because then there's nobody to watch and cheer on the contestants and bring that energy to the room. You can tell the difference between a room that has energy, which is why you have MCs constantly hyping the audience, and a room that's dead. Especially if you, as a first-time cosplayer, are on that stage for the first time. And you get a dead room, and you are terrified.
Yeah.
And the best thing you can do for that cosplayer is to have a rowdy room that's cheering them on.
Absolutely. It makes it so much better.
Yeah, it's in your face. But it makes it so much easier for them to have something to grab onto, to get themselves through that terrifying experience that is being on stage in front of a bunch of people who are judging them, literally. And so you need to have all of those things in mind whenever you're trying to resource the cosplay contest. Make sure your judges are taken care of. Make sure your contestants are taken care of. Make sure your audience is taken care of. And for the love of Pete, have water stations that all three of those groups can properly hydrate and not faint, because nothing will sink a con faster than having people faint at your con because you did not offer them water.
The most basic necessity that we need. Yeah.
Yeah. So just take care of your people is the long and short of it.
Right.
We shouldn't have to say more than that. Just take care of your people.
Yeah. And if you're good,
and they will take care of you.
And they'll take care of you. If you don't want to hassle with cosplayers, then don't make your con have anything cosplay related. We'll find other things to do. We'll go to other events. I know people had way more fun just doing photo shoots far away from the Gaylord as possible, because it was like, we don't want to mess with them. It just bothers me that conventions are still having this issue in 2024. Like, I thought we were past this. And I know some cons are really good about it, and I'm glad that they are. Overwhelming majority are still pretty bad. Like, we as cosplayers should be expecting so much more. Just fair treatment. That's really all we want. We just want to be treated fairly. Both as guests and as an attendee. Like, we just want to be treated fairly. If you treat us fairly, we'll have nothing but glowing reviews about your con. And at the end of the day, that's what's going to be the most powerful marketing tool, that word of mouth. If I say your contest took 12 hours and I had a horrible time and you gave no prizes out, that's going to have way more impact than the $5,000 you spent trying to bring XYZ person in to promote it.
And what surprises me, since you mentioned that we're still seeing this in 2024, is that so many people right now, especially after COVID mitigations have been lifted, people are hungry to go to cons right now.
Yes.
You see posts all over social media of people asking, hey, I'm going to be in this town over the summer, or I'm going to be here in a couple of weeks. What cons should I visit? What's an awesome con for a first-time con goer to go to? I want to go out and meet people. What anime con should I go to? Like, there are so many people who desperately want to go out to cons right now.
Mm-hmm.
many of whom have probably never been to a con since COVID. Some people may have just never been to a con, period. And they're desperate to go out and have fun in a convention setting. But there are so few we can recommend at this point. And it just shocks me, like, how do we not have more cons that are just amazing cons that have learned from all these mistakes from the past years of all these other cons? Because mm-hmm. it's not like we don't talk about them. When you have all of this pent-up demand, people want to give you their money, but they don't want to waste their money.
Exactly.
That's the difference.
Exactly. Not for those $65 to $80 badge prices, sure.
And that's just the badge. That doesn't count parking, hotel, no. food, everything else that you have to pay for at a con. And that's assuming they don't spend any money in the dealer's tent.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot. And to have your trip end in such a disaster is just the most disappointing thing to handle. It's like, I didn't just spend my weekend doing this and it came to nothing, but also like I spent all this money and I've had a bad time. Like, no.
It leaves a really bad taste in your mouth when you spend all that time and effort preparing for something only to have it like severely fall short of your expectations.
Exactly. Like, and to be fair, I understand. I'm not talking about like if you lose a contest, because I know with us, we try really hard to make sure that all of the cosplayers that have entered our contest have felt welcomed, have felt loved, have felt enjoyed the experience, regardless of if they win something or not. This is just, the convention was so bad and I spent money at this thing. Why?
DM has a really good question in chat. Do you find it's different on how cosplayers are treated in different parts of the country?
I saw that too. And I don't think that's the case. It just seems to be very con specific. Like there's a couple of cons that do a great job at taking care of their cosplayers. And then there are others that are not. I don't see any regional differences, at least from the stuff that I've been reading on like the Bluebird app and Reddit and all those places. It seems like it's just, these cons are great. Most of the other ones are pretty bad.
It seems to depend pretty heavily on whether or not the entity the con is based on
mm-hmm.
has a history of valuing cosplay as an entity.
Sure,
not
yeah.
just cosplayers, but like BlizzCon, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Blizzard has long been a proponent of cosplay. Like they will literally give you reference shots
yeah.
in their video games so that you can make the cosplay.
It's a big deal
Dragon
for them,
Con.
Any of the fan community stuff. Yeah.
Right. Dragon Con, long history of supporting cosplay. They have one of the biggest cosplay contests in the country. Both Comic Con, San Diego and New York, long history of supporting cosplay, especially where it comes to comic books.
Right.
So it seems to depend on whether or not like the entity
mm-hmm.
of the con, so like comic books, video games, if it has something specific that is like really attached to cosplay, the con is usually pretty good about treating its cosplayers.
Mm-hmm.
If it doesn't have that hook into cosplay, then like especially with anime cons, I have found that it seems to be less important.
Mm-hmm.
But that could just be my perception.
Yeah, it could be just perception and just the things that we've experienced. Mine has mostly been recently, it's just been a lot of reading other people's thoughts and opinions because they've been to the convention. So they can give me their uh-huh. firsthand account. Because admittedly, uh-huh. I haven't been going to as many cons. One, because COVID. Two, it just nothing has been exciting me because it's been a lot of the same things over and over again. And especially now as I've been thinking more and more about where I am in cosplay, it's like, I don't feel an urge to go to a convention where I'm not going to be treated well simply because I'm cosplaying. Like, no, it's not worth the time or the effort. So I read what other people have been posting.
I've been a little more picky about the cons I go to,
mm-hmm.
Primarily because it's now so expensive
yeah.
to go to any con
yeah.
that I want to make sure that my money is well spent and that I can only do it a certain number of times per year. So it's not like I'm going to, you know, a dozen conventions a year.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I can only afford to go to two or three now. Well, that means I have to make those two or three really count. and that I want them to be cons that I really enjoy, so that I feel like the time and effort that I spent, not just making the money, but making the costumes and all the planning that goes around going to a convention, which, of course, if you would like to review our YouTube channel, where we have many episodes on how to prepare for conventioning, including
packing
your cosplay, maintaining your cosplay, and even how to cook food for your convention.
You have two episodes.
You can find
on that.
Those via our YouTube channel. Sorry for the plug.
Anyway. I should just make a playlist that is just a convention prep guide.
Convention, we should.
Let me hang on. Thank you, Going Ape. You're so nice. I love your costumes. You're such a cool person. Make a convention.
But you have to make it count. And that's the long and short of it. If I'm going to pay, what is it now? If I have two nights of the hotel, plus parking, plus food, plus badge, you're probably reaching up to roughly $600 on average, not counting the cosplay, not counting any purchases in dealer's den. $600 is not inexpensive.
And that's on the low end.
Right. That's assuming like an average hotel at an average con. It's not one of the more expensive ones.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. I don't know. I guess I just feel disappointed. Confused and disappointed.
I feel confused and disappointed too. And it's like, I'm not motivated enough to want to go start my own convention because I know that process. And no. But I'm slowly getting to the point where it's like, if you guys are not going to put on a good convention, I guess I'm just going to have to do it.
It's kind of gotten to the point where I'm less and less motivated to cosplay at cons.
Yeah.
Like, I'll go to the con, but then it's like, well, if there's not really that much cosplay content here, I'm not really interested in their contest, like, why even bother cosplaying at that point, especially if they don't allow you to take pictures? Like, I'll just go in casual clothes.
Yeah.
And as a cosplayer, it's a different experience.
Yes.
Going to a convention in cosplay versus not.
Mm-hmm.
Try it sometime, Potters, if you haven't, and you'll definitely like see the difference. But it's not motivating.
No.
And I want to be motivated. I would totally love to run a cosplay convention, but I also know how insanely expensive that is.
Yes.
And how insanely complicated it is.
Yes.
To run a successful convention, let alone do it over multiple years. Because, like, a one-year convention, I don't know if I can even call that a convention.
Pop-up convention.
It
is hard and
it's
demanding.
Like a meeting.
Yeah, because Amber and I have worked in multiple convention positions over the years, and we have seen pretty much everything. So we would not take on that task lightly. It would be, you would have to really bribe us to do it.
I will mention, for the record, I do not take bribes. but I mean, if at some point in our lives, maybe after we retire,
yeah,
if we wanted to go after that sort of thing, you could rest assured that we would give it the importance.
Oh God, yeah.
That it needs, and that we wouldn't just half-heartedly work on it. Like, you would get our full 100% effort on that.
Like, you all have seen how we ran our costume contest, even our online one. Our line mm-hmm. one, like, we put way too much effort into it. It turned out great. I loved it. So, you know, if we did it, we would put everything into it. That would probably also be like, I am never doing this again. One time is done. This is the pop-up convention. We ain't doing a repeat.
Going Ape, in terms of baked goods, the problem is that baked goods tend to have a sliding subjectivity scale.
Ooh.
So if you wanted to pay in baked goods, like, how would you know how much something is worth?
Also, like, is there dietary restrictions?
Would I have also true. And allergies.
Yeah.
It's like, would you accept this blueberry muffin versus would you accept a brownie? Like, what's the scale on this? It would be a little awkward depending on who you talk to as well. But DM had another question in the chat. What's the biggest change you've seen over time at the conventions? This is going to sound trite, and I don't mean it to. but the shift from fandom to commercialism.
Yes, that's exactly what I was thinking.
And I don't mean that conventions are only focused on making money hand over fist. That's not what I mean. It's more that the focus used to be more on the content mm-hmm. of all of the different events that were offered, whether it's panels, contests, concerts, the guests. It was very much focused on fandom and what do the fans want. We've kind of shifted over to where it's more is better. How many panels can we squeeze into this 24 hours? How many guests can we squeeze in? How much top talent can we get on our website? Like, how many contestants can we squeeze into our contest? It's more. And so the focus is less on the quality, and it seems to be a lot more on the quantity. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a big part of why so many conventions are now getting negative reviews on things, is that that attempt to focus on too much.
Mm-hmm. They're packing everything in to try to get as much money out of it. And then unfortunately, the downside is that the quality takes a massive nosedive, and you're not making as many people happy as you used to. There will still be people that enjoy it and want all access to all of that, and that's great, but the overwhelming majority are gonna be like, you know, this one aspect that I like, I don't like it anymore because the quality is no longer there. Yeah, that would be the same thing that I would say too, is that it's just that shift from the fandom to focusing more on commercialism and capitalism. I understand that cons need money to run. I totally get it. Again, I've been in multiple positions at conventions that I understand. I get it. You need money to be successful, to pay people, and to come back the next year. That's fine. But there's just that mind shift between we're doing this because we have a love of the fandom and we want to have people have fun, get together, showcase that fandom, to making money and only focusing on that. You can feel and see that difference, and it's just not the same experience.
Yeah, I do miss having all of my cosplay focused panels.
Right.
At cons. You'd have all these really talented local cosplayers coming in and teaching like leatherworking mm-hmm. and embroidery and tailoring and all of these really cool things. There's been quite a few like really good painting panels for both the cosmetic painting, like body paint. And then there's also like fabric painting mm-hmm. panels, all of which have been amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, you know, I'd love more of those. And I realize the complaint is normally, well, then cosplayers have to come teach them. But if cosplayers don't feel welcome, or if they don't feel like their content is valued, they're not going to offer the content.
Yeah, we're not going to come
and
teach.
And panelists also expect to be compensated for the time that it takes, because, yeah, your panel's only 45 minutes to an hour. Okay. It probably took them dozens of hours to prep for that hour. Because I know when I taught my panels, it took me about 2 months to prepare.
Yeah.
Because I did like slideshows. I prepped all of the demo materials. I had to go over what I was going to say. I had to research in case there were any questions. It's a ton of prep. And you expect to be compensated for that.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's a free badge or something else. So it's not so much that cosplayers don't want to offer it. It's do they want to offer it for what they're going to get in return?
Exactly.
Also, thank you for spamming cookies in chat.
Cookies. I got a vegan cookie waiting for me after the show. Woo.
There you go.
Anything else that we want to add on the topic of cons don't care about cosplayers?
Not on that topic, but I would love to see from the Potters,
mm-hmm.
If you were to make your ideal con.
We've talked about
this before. We've spent a lot of time talking about like what we think has gone wrong in cons. But I kind of want to hear from the Potters. Like, we've given our opinion on what makes a good con. I want to hear what other people would do if they could make their ideal con.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully some people who are in charge of running other conventions will see this stuff and go, oh, this is what the fans want and are willing to pay for mm-hmm. and spend their time on. Maybe we can make change. Who knows?
Yeah.
But of course, if you would like to join in the conversation and let us know what you would put into your ideal convention, or maybe you'd like to just talk about some experiences that you've also had in many of the conventions that went on within the past month, feel free to join in the conversation via any of our social media, which of course you can find here.
Since this is the YouTube exclusive after session, I don't have to give you the verbal spiel. You can just look at it there, or you can check the notes and the annotations below and you're done. Have fun.
Or of course you can email us podcast@cospod.org. Where you get an answer from each one of us, along with curated Nick Cage memes.
I swear, the moment that we are done, I'm going to send this email with a big apology that says, I am so sorry. I forgot.
Otherwise, please stay safe, stay happy, keep working on those cosplays so that we can see your smiling, shiny faces at a convention local to us ASAP. Otherwise, we will see you all in episode 293. Happy cosplaying, everybody. Good night.
Bye.